The first Life is Strange game came out in 2015, and since then many people have fallen in love with it, including me. The story of the first game mixes time travel and queer awakenings with darker themes of bullying, death, grief and regret, all with beautiful graphics and the most amazing soundtrack. With the latest installment in the series, Life is Strange True Colors, scheduled to be released later this month, I thought now would be the best time to take a deep dive into the game and look into some details and theories I hadn't thought about previously. I found this Life is Strange iceberg on r/icebergcharts on Reddit. It was made by a user called thisismyusername189. There's already a few Life is Strange icebergs on YouTube, but none of them went quite as deep as this one, so I thought I would give it a go. If you're not familiar with the concept of icebergs, it's basically a list of theories, facts, Easter eggs, secrets, or anything really about a given topic. The deeper you go, the more obscure the things get. This video is aimed at explaining each entry on the iceberg in a few words. I won't go too deep into any of them. If you'd like to know more, I will provide links to more information in the description. And if you want me to make a video going more in depth about a specific entry, let me know. If you like this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Let me know what you think in the comments, and there's timestamps in the description so you can skip around if you want to. And let's get started with tier one. The first entry of the Life is Strange iceberg is The Catcher in the Rye. This refers to the multiple references to the J.D. Salinger novel, from the main character's last name, Caulfield, to the movie poster in Max's room that looks like the original edition of The Catcher in the Rye. There's also deeper similarities in character traits and storylines. Hidden rewind sounds. Whenever Max uses her rewind power, a strange sound can be heard. If you pay close attention, this sound contains lines from past and future dialogue.
I did it.
I see you, Max Caulfield.
Okay. Slow down.
Don't think about it until we hear your entry.
Back when the episodes were released one by one, this would give players clues as to what could be expected from future episodes. Katesvid.com. Previously, if players visited the link that Victoria Chase wrote on the bathroom mirror in episode 2, they'd land on a blog with a single post and a video that was removed by YouTube, linking to the fact that Victoria took the video down after Kate's suicide or suicide attempt. It's now just a link that redirects you to the Life is Strange website, unfortunately. What if? This could be referring to several different things, such as the fan film or the webcomic of the same name, both linked below, but it could also be in reference to the fact that Life is Strange was originally named What If. It ended up not being used because of a Daniel Radcliffe film of the same name that was released in 2013. It's also the name of the achievement that the player gets for unlocking all other achievements in the game. License plates. The various license plates seen around Arcadia Bay aren't random. They're based on TV shows, movies, books, as well as real people. Sometimes their names make a lot of sense with the character that the vehicle belongs to. For example, Frank's license plate is based on Breaking Bad, which makes sense, obviously, since he's a drug dealer. Raven symbolism. And Before the Storm, a raven can be seen in a lot of scenes, including Chloe's nightmares. The raven is said to represent transformation and is also feared as a trickster spirit. According to the Native American tribes that inhabited Arcadia Bay, the raven is to be respected but never trusted. In the Native American stories, the trickster is the protagonist of most tales, and their actions, while not meant to change the world, end up having a profound impact upon the world. In this sense, the raven in Before the Storm symbolizes Rachel. Max's doodles. I'm not entirely sure what this entry is referring to. Max doodles a lot in her diary, so this could be what this is about, but one thing that's really interesting is that if you look at Max's diary in the nightmare sequence in Polarized, you will see that the doodles look different and a bit creepier. 8 episodes. If you look into the game files, there's a reference to episodes 1 through 8, although only 5 episodes of the games ended up being released. Also, .NET CEO Oscar Gilbert referred in an interview recorded before the first episode came out to more than 5 episodes, saying, "We want to be able to tell the players when episodes 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. will be available."
On va effectivement pouvoir dire aux joueurs quand est-ce que sortiront les épisodes 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc.
This goes along with the rumors that the game was supposed to be longer but ended up being cut down due to time or money constraints. Chaos Theory. Chaos Theory is the name of episode 3 of Life is Strange, and it refers to the branch of maths that deals with complex systems whose behavior is highly sensitive to slight changes in conditions, so that small alterations can give rise to strikingly great consequences, hinting at the fact that Max's tampering with time does indeed have big consequences. Warren spying on Max. At the beginning of episode 2, just after Max wakes up, if you look through the window, you can see Warren's hiding behind a building and seemingly spying on Max. Max doesn't seem to notice him. "Hey David, what you hiding?"
"Whoa, that is a serious padlock on that locker. Hey David, what you hiding?"
This is a reference to Ashley and Anthony Birch's series of sketch comedy videos called "Hey Ash, what you playing?" from 2008.
"Hey Ashley, what you playing?"
Ashley Birch is the voice actress for Chloe Price. Twin Peaks. Life is Strange contains a lot of references to the TV show Twin Peaks. A few examples are Chloe's license plate, the Pacific Northwest setting, the plot surrounding the disappearance of a popular teenage girl, down to the fact that Rachel Amber and Laura Palmer share the same birthday, the phrase "firewalk with me," Officer Anderson Berry being modeled after Deputy Andy Brennan, and more. Homeless lady is Max. A theory exists that the homeless lady that Max meets behind the Two World Diner is actually Max from the future, but this has been denied by Michelle Koch and Luke Bagadou from Don't Nod during the Blackwell podcast extra live livestream. Homeless lady is Chloe. Another theory is that the woman is actually Chloe, or an alternative version if she hadn't reconnected with Max. As far-fetched as it seems, there are a number of facts that support this claim. The blue butterfly shirt she wears underneath her dark jacket, the fact that she eats the same cereal as Chloe and Max, the fact that Max feels she can trust her as much as she can trust Chloe, and the fact that she knows Max's name without her ever introducing herself. Some people say even her physical appearance, eyes and mouth in particular, resembles an old, battered version of Chloe. The butterfly effect. The game's events start with a photo of a blue butterfly and ends with a tornado. The butterfly to tornado thing perfectly mimics the scientific paper written in 1972 by a meteorologist called Edward Lorenz, entitled "Predictability: Does the Flap of a Butterfly's Wings in Brazil Set Off a Tornado in Texas?" Lighthouse symbolism. The lighthouse represents safety and guidance, and it's quite literally a beacon against the darkness. It can be interpreted that the building watches over Arcadia Bay. It's also present in the vision that warns Max against the storm. In episode 5, it becomes apparent that the lighthouse is the only safe place for Max and Chloe, as it's out of the path of the tornado. Nostalgic feel of the game. Despite the game taking place in 2013, which is just 2 years before it came out, its overall atmosphere provokes a sense of nostalgia in the player. I think it's due to a combination of the music, the lighting, the references to movies and songs from the 80s and 90s, the overall artistic style that almost looks like a painting sometimes, and the fact that Chloe and Max are two former childhood best friends that are reunited. Tier 2. Chloe's phone wallpaper. Chloe originally has a photo of herself and Rachel Amber as a phone wallpaper. However, after Chloe and Max leave Blackwell in episode 3, you have a chance to look at Chloe's phone again, and there's a chance that she might have changed her phone wallpaper to a photo of Max. For that to happen, you have to pick 3 of the 4 following choices. Take the blame for Chloe's weed, don't answer Kate's phone call, choose to shoot Frank, steal the money from the handicap fund. Rachel is the storm. This is the theory that Rachel is behind the storm, that the storm is her revenge for the way she was killed and perhaps her way of destroying the town she never got to leave. It's also linked to the next entry in a way. Rachel has superpowers. There's a few things that hint towards Rachel having the ability to control the wind or the fire. For example, when the bin catches fire, she screams and the wind seems to pick up, making the fire spread quickly. Later, when she's in the hospital, you can hear a firefighter say that the fire died all of a sudden, which can be linked to the fact that she got stabbed and lost consciousness. Another theory is that she also has time powers like Max, which she used to become popular, get good grades without doing much work, and guess every one of Chloe's truths and lies when they're playing the game on the train. Ouroboros. In Polarize, Chloe wears a t-shirt with an Ouroboros on, which is a serpent eating its own tail. It represents the endless cycle of life, death, and rebirth. It can be linked to the fact that Chloe can start a new life by leaving Arcadia Bay behind. It could also emphasize the fact that history repeats itself and that Chloe is doomed to die no matter what happens. There's also fan fiction by the same name. Director's commentary. There's a whole director's commentary, which is too long to talk about in detail here, but they did mention a few interesting things, such as the fact that the name Rachel was chosen because it's a hybrid of the first names of the directors, Raoul and Michelle, and that the directors confirmed that the doe is a presence of Rachel that guides Max throughout the game. No fucks given. Max wears a t-shirt with jumbled up letters in 2008, and the letters read, "No fucks given." Cassidy then has a no fucks patch in Life is Strange 2, which is a reference to that. Thanks for crying! At the end of the credits for Dark Room, which has a horrible ending, the screen reads, "Thanks for crying," instead of "Thanks for playing." Rachel gave Max rewind powers. Another Rachel theory is that she gave Max her powers so that she could save Chloe, find her buddy, get revenge, and in turn create the storm and destroy Arcadia Bay, which she always wanted to escape but couldn't. Max and Chloe are in New York. If you chose to save Chloe at the end of Life is Strange, when meeting David in Life is Strange 2, he gets a phone call from Chloe and mentions something about New York, hinting at the fact that that's where they are.
Hey, sweetie. What's up? No shit. Told you New Yorkers were assholes.
Rachel is the ghost doe. As mentioned earlier, the theory is that the ghost doe is Rachel in spirit form, which makes sense since it appears over her burial site and again when Rachel is discovered. The directors confirmed that in their commentary. 555 phone numbers. Whenever a phone number is mentioned in the game, it is given the prefix 555. This is a fictional prefix which is widely used in American TV shows, movies, and video games in order to prevent callers from bothering real people by giving them fake phone numbers. Japanese dub. Not much to say about this other than there is a Japanese version of the game.
当然ながら写真についても同じことが言えるだろう。ここはいつもの教室。大丈夫。落ち着こう。Max
breaks the fourth wall. In the diner sequence of Max's nightmare in episode 5, Polarized, Max has to enter a code to exit the diner bathroom. If you enter the incorrect code 50 times, the door will open and Max will say,
"I'm going to make the designers pay for all these bullshit code puzzles."
Santa Monica Dream is about Rachel and Chloe. And before the storm, Rachel tries to convince Chloe to escape with her to Santa Monica. Later in the timeline, in Life is Strange, Chloe listens to Santa Monica Dream, which undoubtedly reminds her of Rachel and how their dream never came true.
Chloe, are you okay?
Sure, I'm awesome. I just want to blaze and be alone for a moment.
Tier 3. Dana, Courtney, and Taylor are claiming Mr. Jefferson. When Mr. Jefferson gets on stage to do his speech during the end of the world party, a few female voices can be heard acclaiming him. The audios for the game confirm that it's Dana, Courtney, and Taylor. Dana calls him sexy, whereas Courtney and Taylor both say he's hot. Yikes.
About entering. Now this...
Casey Believer. I believe this is referring to a post by a user called Casey Believer on gamefaqs.gamespot.com, in which they discuss possible plot points based on content that was leaked prior to the release of episode 2. The post is still up, and it looks like their predictions were pretty much all true, unless the post was edited afterwards. Arcadia Bay zip code. The zip code for Arcadia Bay seems to change depending on where you look. On a postcard sent to Chloe, Rachel wrote Chloe's address stating that Arcadia Bay's zip code is 97141, which is the real zip code for Tillamook, Oregon. Another postcard sent by someone called Amori contains the same zip code. However, on the auto repair invoice, the shop's address in Arcadia Bay states a different zip code, 97603, which belongs to Klamath Falls, Oregon. Max is Rachel Amber. Some people theorize that Rachel is Max from a different timeline, while other people say they are two different personalities belonging to the same person. This is very easily disproven since they have different dates of birth and look different, but it's interesting nonetheless. Unused music. There's a bunch of content that ended up not being used in the final product. For example, for Before the Storm, there's a Firewalk song that didn't end up being used, as well as an instrumental version of A Hole in the Earth by Daughter. They're both linked in the description. Episode 1, American Chrysalis. If you look at the entertainment software rating board website, Life is Strange Episode 1 is called American Chrysalis instead of just Chrysalis. I'm not sure if it was the original title or if the ESRB just goofed and gave it a different name. Episode 2, Time Out. Same thing for Episode 2, it's called Time Out on the ESRB website instead of Out of Time, which is its actual name. Aurora Creek. This was the original name of Arcadia Bay before writer Christian Devine suggested Arcadia Bay as a name. Leftovers of its original name can still be found in the game's files. The textures for the Arcadia Bay map by the Lighthouse are called Aurora Creek map, and the game file for the large picture of Arcadia Bay that hangs in the upstairs hallway at Chloe's house is named Aurora Creek. Life is... This is in reference to the fact that the characters of the game sometimes get close to saying the title of the game but never actually do. For example, after altering the past by handing in her Everyday Heroes contest photo to Jefferson in episode 5, Max finds herself in the San Francisco Art Gallery and she says,
"Life is weird."
Also, in Max's nightmare, alternative Chloe appears and blames Max. Before she disappears, she says,
"Life is so not fair."
Polarized title reference. The term polarized isn't only a photography term, it also refers to a choice between two big conflicting decisions. This is an obvious reference to the huge choice that Max has to make at the end of the game between saving Chloe and saving Arcadia Bay. By the way, make sure you let me know in the comments which one you picked. Characters were looking directly at the eclipse. This refers to the fact that at the end of episode 2, characters such as Max and Warren are staring directly at the unexpected eclipse. This would realistically be very dangerous and could cause retinal damage, so it's a bit weird that they're doing that without consequences. To All of You interpretation. The song To All of You by Sid Matters plays on a loop at the beginning of the game. The song romanticizes the American lifestyle and highlights the role of the American girl. The simplest interpretation is that the game focuses on the fate of its female characters, who are, indeed, American girls. It can also be seen as criticizing the way that women are traditionally presented in American media with shiny smiles and plastic bodies, whereas the main characters in Life is Strange don't fit this stereotype, either in their appearance or in the way they take their destiny into their own hands, showing strength and courage. Elysian's Journal Pinterest Board. This refers to the fact that Elysian, the illustrator that worked on Max's diary, created a Pinterest board to gather her inspirations, which is still up and definitely interesting to look at. Amori references. Amori Ballandier is a French illustrator and environment artist working for Dotnod Entertainment. As the lead environment artist for Life is Strange, he was significantly involved in the game's creation and development. His name can be seen in a few places in the game, such as on the list of yearbook committee members or in a postcard to Chloe Price. Tier 4. Don't Nod. This is in reference to the fact that Max nods her head when the Don't Nod logo comes up in the intro. William and Rachel were supposed to be in the nightmare. According to unused voice lines, Chloe's dad was supposed to be in the nightmare asking Max why she didn't save him. Rachel was also supposed to have several lines of dialogue during the sequence, but they were never recorded. Old choice music. This refers to an unused audio which could have been the choice background music, but it was replaced by the one we all know and love. Mr. Jefferson's phone call. In episode 2, Mark Jefferson has a weird phone call where he seems kind of stressed and eager to cut the conversation short. There's a lot of theories as to who he could be talking to, but one of the most popular is that he's talking to Sean Prescott, Nathan's father. Max was going to have a roommate. In early concept art for Max's room, Max appears to have had an environmentally conscious roommate. A poster that appears in Victoria's room in the game can be seen under the bunk. This could mean that Victoria was going to be Max's roommate, but concept art for Victoria's room also exists, so it could also just be someone else. Blue Moon Diner. The Two Wells Diner likely is based on the Blue Moon Diner located in Beaverton, Oregon. The interior is incredibly similar, and there's a newspaper article in the airplane in episode 5 with the headline Two Moon Diner, which connects the names of the two diners with each other. Native American culture. Native American tribes have originally inhabited and founded Arcadia Bay, and their culture can be seen around the town, such as the Tabanga Totem, currently standing on the Blackwell Dormitory grounds. Some of the theories behind what caused the storm suggest that the Native American history of the area has something to do with it. Kate's Doodles. Kate's drawings used to be cute and child-friendly, fit for a kid's book. But with all the bullying and her declining mental health, they seem to take a dark turn. If you save Kate, when she's in hospital, she starts drawing children's illustrations again, planning on creating a new book about bullying. Forest fire theories. As mentioned earlier, there is suspicion that Rachel is somehow controlling the fire. She seems to be able to make it gain intensity at will, and it seemingly becomes extinct right after she gets stabbed, to the amazement of two firemen at the hospital. Unused tattoos, outfits, and hairstyles. This is part of a load of unused content. Here we can see a different tattoo design for Chloe, as well as different outfits and hairstyles for some of the characters. Raymond Wells concept art. This refers to the early concept art of Principal Wells, in which we can see various ethnicities and outfits. Tornado theories. This refers to the various theories surrounding the cause of the tornado. The game seems to want us to think that Max caused it, but a lot of players aren't satisfied with this explanation. Theories go from blaming the Prescotts to suggesting Native American involvement or saying, as mentioned earlier, that Rachel caused the storm herself. I found those theories really interesting, so tell me yours in the comments. Tier 5. This file name. This video is an early version of the episode 5 teaser video. It shows what seems to be an unfinished Mark Jefferson in the dark room. This file was removed from episode 3's files with episode 4's release. Unused letter from Nathan to Mr. Jefferson. This can be found in the unused graphics for the game. This letter is interesting because it gives some clues regarding Nathan's relationship with Jefferson. And it also confirms that Nathan did, in fact, hurt and maybe even kill Rachel. Jesse. The name of some of the assets of the game, such as the photo of Chloe and Rachel found under her bed and the postcard from Rachel, suggest that at some point in the game's development, Rachel was going to be called Jesse. Destroyed Lighthouse. This entry refers to the fact that in the cutscene following the Save Chloe ending, the lighthouse, which was partly destroyed during the storm, can be seen missing its top part, making it seemingly half as tall as earlier in the game. Kate's Rabbit. In episode 2, we are introduced to Kate's rabbit, Alice, which is obviously an Alice in Wonderland reference. Depending on whether or not we manage to save Kate, in the next episode, Max will either be taking care of the bunny until Kate gets out of hospital, or will adopt it after Kate's death, which is heartbreaking. Unused character. Among the unused graphics, a seemingly unused character's concept art by Fred Ogier can be seen. Ladybug in clock. When entering Chloe's living room in episode 4, Max notices that the clock has stopped. This causes her to wonder if it was her messing with time that caused it to break, but upon closer inspection, it appears that there is a ladybug stuck in the dials. Why Max got her powers? This is pretty much up to the player's interpretation. While the wiki refers to her powers as being likely triggered by the shocking experience of seeing a blue-haired girl get shot in the girls' bathroom at Blackwell Academy, most players seem to think that there's a lot more to it. Let me know your theories in the comments. Max is a scapegoat. Anima Gaming made an excellent video about this theory, which I will link below. Basically, this is the theory that Max wasn't responsible for the storm. The actual reason was a lot more complex, but a lot of the story had to be cut. This led to Max taking the blame for it, even though she is innocent. Kate's secret wine. Despite Kate telling Max that she doesn't drink, you can find a bottle of wine in her room. This led people to believe that she was using alcohol to cope with her depression. Kate bought drugs from Frank. There is a Katie on Frank Bowers' client list, codenamed as Chihuahua. This led some people to believe that Katie is Kate Marsh, however the developer confirmed that Katie and Kate Marsh are not the same person. Jefferson knows about Max's powers. A popular theory is that Mark Jefferson knows about Max's powers. He does seem to hint at her special abilities throughout the game and mentions her gift. However, this theory can be disproven by his surprise when Max warns David before he even comes into the room in episode 5.
David, watch out!
How? How did you know that?
Samuel's office. This refers to the unused concept art of Samuel's janitor room. Samuel is a cross-dresser. This refers to the box containing shades and quote-unquote other crap, as well as a silk scarf and a fashion magazine that can be found in Samuel's shed. People have said that this could mean he likes to dress as a woman, or that he collects those items as a lost and found, or my favourite, that he bought them as gift for Mrs. Grant. These two file names. Both are early versions of the intro to episode 3, which ended up not being used. Tier 6. Lure interpretation. Lure is a song by Bright Eyes, which appears in Life is Strange during the 3rd episode, where it is played by Chloe Price in her room, and the 4th episode where it can be played by Max in Chloe's room. The song's line, "We might die from medication, but we sure killed all the pain," could be foreshadowing Chloe's fate in the alternative timeline. Stella bought drugs from Frank. Frank's drug dealer book shows that Stella has bought ADHD medication from him at least once. ADHD medication is known to be used by college students as stimulants to help study and improve concentration. Since Stella doesn't have much money and needs to work as well as study, it unfortunately might lead her to resort to those pills to improve her performance. Nathan knew about the storm. This refers to an unused audio of Nathan after fighting with Warren in the dorms.
The storm is coming! Oh! You're all gonna die! I see you! I see all of you, and you're all gonna die! The storm is still coming! And you, you're all dead! You're all dead, you hear me? Dead!
I saw it. I saw the storm.
This unused audio file indicates that it was planned to reveal that Nathan knew about the storm. One of the game directors later confirmed in an interview that it was thought to be in episode 5. But it was scrapped pre-release because it didn't make enough sense story-wise, and there weren't enough hints to this before the final episode. Out of time, leaked build. This refers to a leaked build of episode 2, which was allegedly posted on 4chan on February 6, 2015. The leak for episode 2 was confirmed to be genuine on the Steam community forums, and fans were urged not to download the incomplete build and instead wait for the official release date, which was scheduled in March 2015. The early build had some glitches and graphical bugs which confirmed that it was an unfinished build. There was also elements in the leaked build that were different or no longer present at all in the complete version of the episode. Bay Ocean, Oregon. This is in reference to the fact that Arcadia Bay might be meant to represent the town of Bay Ocean, Oregon, which was destroyed over the course of 40 years by man-made erosion. Warren's violent nature. Although Warren comes across as your typical good guy at first glance, there's a few signs that show he might not actually be that nice. As mentioned earlier, he fully spies on Max through a bedroom window. He also mentions some really weird films such as Cannibal Holocaust, I'm pretty sure I can't say that on YouTube, and says he laughed his ass off at it. He also seems to lose control when beating up Nathan if Max doesn't intervene, showing a new violent side to his personality that neither the player nor Max has come across before. Interestingly, in Max's nightmare, she comes across Warren's locker, which is full of creepy stuff showing his obsession with her, which shows us that Max is also a bit worried about his behaviour. Rebirth, not death. This is a title of a video by Vexwolf, which talks about how Life is Strange is about rebirth and second chances rather than death and consequences. It's linked in the description, go check it out. Future Max left the message and farewell. Another really interesting theory is that the message that Max left on the tape recorder for Chloe to find when she gets back from her dad's funeral was recorded by 19-year-old Max and not 13-year-old Max. I've linked a video by channel Stop Me O that goes into this theory a bit more. It's easily debunked, but it's interesting nonetheless. Melissa Lee Grayson is the homeless lady. Another theory in regards to the identity of the mysterious homeless lady behind the diner speculates that it's Melissa Lee Grayson who went missing in 1997. The photo of her provided on the Arcadia Bay Police Department's website is said to look similar to the homeless woman. You let me know what you think. Red versus Blue. This is another fun theory that opposes blue characters to red characters, with the blue ones being the good characters or the ones that the player tends to like, while red represents the bad guys. This is based on a video by Qchao, which I really recommend, and it's, again, in the description. Hospital ending. The hospital ending was an alternate version of the Sacrifice Chloe ending planned for the original Life is Strange, in which Chloe Price would have fallen into a coma instead of being killed. The scene would have shown Max waking up in the hospital next to Chloe's hospital bed instead of attending Chloe's funeral. As much as I would have preferred that ending, because obviously I don't want Chloe to die, I do understand why it was scrapped, because it does reduce the impact of your decision. Kelly Davis. At the end of Chrysalis, you can see the red folders in a dark room, and you can see that the one just before Rachel's is named Kelly. Later on in Polarize, during the nightmare, Max walks around the dorms as they were when Rachel was attending Blackwell, and you can see on the map that a girl called Kelly Davis was staying in room 217, which is opposite Rachel's old room. It has been confirmed by Don't Nod that these two are the same Kelly. And finally, moving on to Tier 7. Fate always wins. This is a bit of a vague entry, but to me it refers to the fact that maybe Chloe is destined to die, as shown by how many times she quote-unquote dies throughout the game and Max has to rewind time to save her. Chloe herself says that at the end as well.
I know I've been selfish, but for once, I think I should accept my fate. Our fate, Chloe.
Max's nightmare was her in purgatory. I couldn't find a post or video regarding this theory, but I believe this refers to the fact that some aspects of the nightmare, especially the repeating corridors in the dorms and the reminders of her choices and their consequences, seem consistent with descriptions of what purgatory is supposed to be. The Prescotts are ritualists slash cultists. I believe this is in reference to the fact that the Prescotts, a rich and influential family, could be linked to a secret society or New World Order type thing, hence why they know about the storm and own a literal bunker that's called the Stormbreaker. Ideograms. These Chinese characters can be seen on various items and can be translated to French bread or French pastry. They have been discovered on 5 items so far. One of Jefferson's photographs, Jefferson's Eroguro poster, which is cropped here because it's quite disturbing, a manga magazine belonging to Chloe in 2008, the cardboard used by Frank to hide the inside of his RV, and a poster above Max's desk. Chloe hooked up and had a romantic relationship with Elliot because he reminds her of William. The channel No Whiskey Rose got into more detail about this, but basically it's theorized that after William's death, Chloe needed comfort and found it with Elliot. And it's possible that his similar look to William, as well as his seemingly calm and down-to-earth personality, might have subconsciously reminded her of her dad. Blue Sunshine Film and Kate Marsh. This really stumped me at first. When I googled Blue Sunshine, I discovered that it's a really wacky horror film from the 70s about a form of LSD called Blue Sunshine that turned people into bald, murderous psychopaths. I really struggled to find a link with Kate Marsh, but then looking at Frank's notebook again, it looks like the acid his soul to that Katie we talked about earlier is called Blue Sunshine. Since there's a theory, albeit false, that Katie is Kate Marsh, I think that's where this entry came from. This file name. This is the name of an audio file that can be found in the game files for episode 3. It features Officer Berry's voice saying,
"Since you know so much about episode 2, maybe you should tell me what's going on. I sure hope you're not proud of yourself for playing a leaked, incomplete game. And if you do it again, next time you roll through Arcadia Bay, might be your last time. Choose wisely."
Elis thought that this audio file was left in the game files for the leakers of episode 2 to find. Robbery scene. In the very early stages of writing, a robbery scene was planned, where Chloe gets the idea to do a robbery to test Max's powers. It was written as a way to show Max and Chloe early on having fun with Max's powers, but the diner and junkyard ended up serving the same purpose. The robbery would have also addressed the topic of stealing, but this is presented at a later point in the game when Chloe wants to take the money in the principal's office. "I can't live here anymore" secret message. "I Can't Live Here Anymore" is a song by Daughter that was on the Before the Storm soundtrack. It was soon discovered that the song seems to have subliminal messages hidden in it. Here is some of it reversed. Tell me if you can hear anything. Judging by Elliot's outburst in Before the Storm episode 3, he may have been inspired by Elliot Rodger. Elliot Rodger was an incel who killed 7 people in Isla Vista, California. The name choice, as well as Elliot's aggressive behaviour in episode 3 and his creepy poem seemingly about Chloe, does suggest that Elliot Rodger was an inspiration for the character. William is a Prescott. I am guessing that this theory is simply that William Price is somehow related to Sean and Nathan Prescott, but I actually couldn't find anything about it online, so if you know anything, let me know. Max of Many Faces. This is another anima gaming theory, which suggests that each change that Max made in the timeline created a new different Max that has no knowledge of what's to come. And finally, the loss of innocence. I believe this is in reference to Mark Jefferson's obsession with the idea of, quote,
"capturing that moment, innocence evolves into corruption."
He's so obsessed with it that he goes way too far, even kidnapping, drugging, and eventually killing to get his perfect shot. And that brings us to the end of this Life is Strange iceberg video. If you made it this far, thank you so much. I would love to hear your favourite part, or if you have a theory or a trivia fact or an Easter egg that I haven't mentioned, please tell me all about it in the comments. I want to thank This Is My Username 189 again. If you're watching this, thank you for creating this iceberg. I had so much fun diving into all the different entries. I hope I did okay for my first iceberg video. I really want to do more. Specifically, I would love to do one about Life is Strange 2. So if you know about an iceberg for that game, let me know. As always, my sources are listed in the description along with my social media. Thanks again for watching. Subscribe if you haven't already. I'm trying to reach 1,000 subscribers. And press the notification bell so you know when I upload. See you next time. Bye.